In this short tutorial, we're going to look at completing the analysis of the table shown. What we've done in the first two tutorials was look at the wood surface of the table by itself and developed our first model there. Then in the second tutorial, we added the C channel on the back and we looked at interactions between different parts. In this tutorial, we're going to add in the frame, a larger wireframe in 3D, and then we're going to look at the interaction between that and the table surface. Here's the view that we had last time. Let's get on over to create our new part for the frame. Okay, so first off, always remember when you're adding a section to your model, go ahead and create a copy of your model. And that way you can always return to your prior version. So I'm going to call this table full. And then make sure you're working in the table full model here in your context menu. So now I'm going to add a new part. So create a part. This is going to be a 3D wire part. I'm going to start out planar because that's my only option. We're going to have to do a few tricky things to make this three-dimensional wire mesh that represents the table's frame. I'll walk you through the process. Okay, so we've got the basic outline of the frame. Let's get some dimensions in there, and then we'll probably want to add some angles as well. So this is going to be 24 inch along that side length. It's going to be 24 inches across the top piece. And then what I'm going to do this time is add a constraint. I'm going to say equal length between this part and hold down shift, choose that part, say done. Now I don't need to separately dimension this part because I've said they have to be the same length. Now I'm going to add some angle dimensions. So all I have to do is click on the part and then go over to the next part and it will default to giving me an angle. And I want that to be 120 degrees at that angle. We're going to do the same thing between these two parts. 120 degrees there. Okay, so that's my basic frame shape. Cancel out of selecting the dimension and say done. Remember, don't cancel the sketch because then you have to do it all again. Say done. There's my sketch. Now what I want to do is, let's assume this is the top of my frame. By the way, I accidentally did not label that properly. We can go in and change it now. Open up your tree, do a rename, and just say frame. Okay, so what I want to do is add additional legs to this going vertically downwards. So first off, let's change my perspective a little bit. And then what I want to do is create some points that I can then connect wires to in order to get the rest of the frame. So I'm going to create datum points. I don't want to enter coordinates. What else can I do? I can offset from a point. That sounds perfect because I'm going to be going vertically downward from the four points shown. So let's start with the outside corner. And I want to go down 24 inches is where my crossbars are. Let me show you the figure again. So this distance here is 24 inches and then an additional 10 inches down to the floor. So I need a point that's 24 inches down. Down in this view, it's hard to see in that current orientation. Okay, so that is the Z direction. So I want to go 0, 0, negative 24. Okay, fit it all to size. Okay, that's where I got my point. Okay, so I'm going to continue this for the other four corners, and then I'm going to go from these points down an additional 10. I'll pause the video. Okay, as you can see now, I have created the points for where my cross beams are going to go, and then the bottom, or the floor point, contact point. I'm ignoring the wheels. We'll just represent them as being able to slide here. So now what I want to do is add to my frame using these points that I've created. We're going to do that using the create wire, but I don't want to draw again. So I press and hold, and it gives me the option to create a wire going point to point. Select that option. It gives me a pop-up window, which might make you think that you need to enter in coordinates of points. And in fact, you can do that if you choose to. But what we want to do instead is actually click on the green plus here, and that will allow me to select points in the viewport. But before I do that, let's take a quick look at the settings. It's going to do a polyline, so that's creating additional lines, or a spline would be if I want it to curve. Straight lines are appropriate for this. Do I want to imprint a wire or merge a wire? I want to merge it with the existing wires. I don't want to have separate ones. And then, do I want to have separate wires or do I want to chain them together? Well, I could do a chain around here, but certainly the verticals I can do as separate ones. I think it's easier if I just say disjoint for all of them, then I can just choose point to point. So I click add and I can select one point and then the point it's connected to and so on. Order doesn't matter, just make the connections you need to make. So a little bit of jump there. I've gone ahead and connected all of those points just by clicking on them in pairs. And now I am done. And it's given me a list of everything that I connected here. I can say okay. And I now have my complete frame. And that part is now done as a 3D part. So you can see there are secondary operations that you can do on different part types. Okay, go to property module. This is going to use the material steel that I already have, so I don't need to add a material. However, each of these beams, or each of these layers, I suppose you'd say, the top piece is a certain type of tube, the cross pieces are a different type, and then the verticals are a third. So I've actually got three different cross sections that I need to enter. I'm going to have to define profiles for each of them and sections for each of them. I'm going to start with the profiles, and they are going to be box profiles. And I'm going to call this top beam for the ones that go across the top. These are 1 inch outside, 1 by 1, and then 1/8 inch thick. So the width is 1, the height is 1, and the thickness is 0.125. Remember, it's important to look at the figure here. These are outside dimensions, and that's true for me because I'm using tube, not pipe. Just make sure you're entering the appropriate dimensions. So I go and repeat that for my other two. All right, that's three profiles, so now I have to define three sections. Top beam. So after defining all three sections, and now I've added leg, cross brace, and top beam as three additional sections. So I need to define what geometry those sections relate to. Now it's important to note that even though I only have a single part here, I can have multiple sections in it. That's what we're going to see right now. Assign a section. Select the regions to assign a section. I'm going to choose the top, then choose the section, top beam, and I just continue this, and you're going to see they turn blue. Continue that by choosing the next region. Okay, you can see it's all turned blue because I've got all of my sections assigned. So I'm done with property assembly. I need to add this part to the assembly, or create an instance of it rather. So the frame I'm going to add into the assembly. I'm going to leave it as dependent. Okay, it comes in. Now, here's the interesting thing. This frame, when I bring it over here, it's going to directly align with the table. But in fact, I cheated a little bit with my first model. The tabletop is actually larger than the frame, and I've just neglected the edges of it because I wanted to have my boundary conditions on the edge of the table. So I'm actually going to have to modify my tabletop, and I'll show you how to do that in a moment. For right now, let's take a look at what sort of connections that we want to have, so the constraints that we're going to add. So the actual physical constraint between these parts is the table rests on the top surface of the frame. There are going to be two pins on the frame on this narrow side. They're close to the end, so I'll probably just assume that they're at the ends. And those pins prevent sliding in the X and Y direction of the tabletop. The only thing actually preventing the tabletop from coming up is right at the back corner here, there's a magnet attached to this frame. So I will have a vertical constraint here, I'll have contact all along the edges, and then I'll have an XY constraint at these corners. Okay, So let's see about getting those in. First of all, get to interaction and let's look at the contact. I want to create an interaction. I'm going to have a surface-to-surface interaction. Select the master surface. So I'm going to rotate around a little bit so I can see the bottom side of the tabletop. And that's what I want to be my master surface. And then I want the purple side to be the side, since that's facing, that's the side that I want the contact to find. And the slave can be a node region. So that's why I chose the tabletop as the master. I want to choose a node region, and then that's going to be made up of these wires along the top edge there. And there are a lot of choices that we have when we're looking at a surface contact condition, but most of these should be fine for most cases. The only thing you really have to add is an interaction property. And just like the profile, we've got a little button here. We could go over and define the interaction property directly, or we can use this button. So this is going to be contact interaction. And I need to define the normal behavior, the thing that prevents it from going through. Otherwise, the two meshes will go right past each other. By default, I'll stick with the hard contact. Separation after contact, I think I want that because I want the opposite corners to lift off if they need to. So I'll say OK. And then I'll say OK here because that defaulted in because I built it. So now I've got a contact defined. You can see hollow squares shown to indicate that interaction. The X and the Y interaction, let's for the moment say that we're not going to worry about that. Let's do a tie at these outside corners, perhaps. Now, first, let's go back and change the size of the part. So my part tabletop is the wrong size right now. So pull open the part, and then I open the feature. And then I can say I want to edit that feature. If I want to change the drawing, I just click on the pencil here, edit section sketch. And now the dimensions that I want to have are 27 inches across this top. So edit a dimension, 27 is going to be 54. I want to actually delete this eraser here. I want to delete these two dimensions. Now this is not quite defined yet. The one thing that I need to add is going to be the angle constraint. I can either do 120 up there or 60 degrees down here. And I say regenerate on OK. That means it's going to reshape the part. So now it's the larger size. Now, when I've done that to the part, it's going to carry over to the assembly, but not automatically. See this yellow check here saying that it's modified. I need to update or regenerate the instances. So now this is the right size. Notice that I'm going to have to do my crossbar as well. Go back to the crossbar part and change the length of it, and then I have to reposition it. So when you make modifications, it's not straightforward. There are techniques, but it does take a little bit of time to go through them. If we go back to our assembly view, now I need to do a translate instance for my C channel. And I want to move it so that it's again in contact. And now what I want to do is move my tabletop frame up into this position. I'm going to translate this point up to there, but then my table is going to be offset, so I'll have to slide the whole thing back in the X direction. So it'll be a two-stage translation. You want to grab both of your parts, since you've already put those in the same position, you now want to move them together. So first I move it up to here, and then I translate again the two of them together. And this time I have to enter the number. So I do 000 for the start point, and then the end point is going to be 300 to move it 3 inches in the X direction. And that looks good. Okay, so what have I not done? You're always asking yourself this in the model. I've got the full model built. I've positioned things appropriately. I have contact defined. So go on, I'm not gonna change the load. Oh, I do need to change something in the load. That's what I forgot. This boundary condition needs to change. I no longer want it around the edge of my part. I want to change the region. So I can click on this arrow and I can choose a new region for that boundary condition, which is going to consist of just the nodes at the bottom here of my frame. So now my boundary condition is there rather than being up on the tabletop. I need to mesh my frame. Oh, and I also need to remesh my tabletop because I changed the length. We should just mesh everything. And I missed a step. This is pretty typical for me on the first time through in a model. I'll usually leave something out. So we did define profiles, but we forgot the beam orientation. So we need to go back to the property module and add beam orientations. Now, the main thing here is that these are squares. So I just need to have the top surface horizontal. I believe I can select everything. Done. And then define the N1 direction to be in the positive Y. Okay, so this worked the way that I expected it to work on the cross braces and the top. So the one direction is horizontal everywhere, and that's what I wanted. It did not work for the legs. The legs, I actually want to think about that orientation a bit more. Actually, the one direction on the legs should be fine. Okay, I think we're okay. So what Abaqus does is it takes the vector that you give it and it chooses the closest vector that's perpendicular to the line to be the one direction. Okay, back to submit the job. Let's see if it works. Okay, this is a good point to end our second tutorial. So you've seen all those tips on how to build the model. Now we're seeing a common issue that shows up when you have contact interactions. Too many attempts made for this increment means that the software can't figure out where everything goes. In other words, we've created a dynamic situation rather than a static situation. So I'll show you in the next tutorial how to handle that.